Hey, it's George Chuang. Let's continue our study, starting in Mark 2. Jesus is beginning his ministry and his popularity has grown tremendously. Mark 2, verse 1. And again, he entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. Immediately, many gathered together so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door, and he preached the word to them. Jesus preached the word. You can preach about many things. You can go to the self-help section at any bookstore and find all kinds of things to preach on. Some of the things can be helpful, such as habits of successful men. It's good to have good habits. Some of the topics could have biblical truths. Oftentimes, it's biblical truths mixed with a poison. The prosperity gospel contains some biblical truths, but it's mixed with poison. It's true, God does want his people to prosper. That was the whole point of the Israelites going to the promised land, to enjoy a land flowing with milk and honey. But prosperity is a very general and broad view of God's desires. That desire often applies to an entire nation or a people group if they do what is right and follow the ways of God. When a nation prospers, does it mean every person will prosper and be rich? No, but many will enjoy the prosperity. So from a general perspective, God desires Christians to prosper and not be persecuted. He hears the cries of those who are persecuted. Now, if this is God's general desire for his people, is this true for every individual? And the answer is no. Throughout the Bible, some of the godliest men suffered the most. This is true for both the Old and New Testament. God's main desire is for you to grow spiritually. And oftentimes, this involves some form of hardship and affliction. When people prosper, they tend to get lazy and start doing evil. So God is much more concerned about your spiritual growth and your eternal rewards in heaven than he is about your treasures on earth. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 4, 9 to 11, "For I think that God has displayed us, the apostles, last as men condemned to death. For we have been made a spectacle to the world, both to angels and to men. We are fools for Christ's sake, but you are wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You are distinguished, but we are dishonored." Maybe some of these guys at Corinth were prosperity gospel teachers or something, but some of them were puffed up against Paul. "To the present hour, we both hunger and thirst, and we are poorly clothed and beaten and homeless." Paul and the other apostles apparently didn't have the faith to prosper financially like the many prosperity gospel teachers we have today. Either that or they forgot to sow their seed. They didn't sow their seed and get a sevenfold blessing. Now, some prosperity gospel teachers go so far as to say, you shouldn't even be persecuted because persecution is of the devil and the world. But we have overcome both. So if you're persecuted, you lack faith in Christ, which is contrary to the words of Christ, who said, if they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. Concerning those that fall away, Jesus said in Mark 4, verse 16, "These likewise are the ones sown on stony ground, who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with gladness, and they have no root in themselves, and so endure only for a time. Afterward, when tribulation or persecution arises for the word's sake, immediately they stumble." Now, the more reasonable prosperity gospel teachers admit you will have persecution. That's expected, but you should still prosper financially. So Paul said, "To the present hour, we both hunger and thirst, and we are poorly clothed and beaten and homeless." Okay, beaten is expected, but why are the apostles hungry and thirsty, poorly clothed, and homeless? Well, if they had my kind of faith, they would be living in a mansion. I advise you to flee that doctrine. The prosperity gospel often works in nations that are wealthy, where the people are naturally prospering, like the USA. A pastor can get incredibly rich if the people he preaches to already have money and want more, so they sow their seed. But very unfortunately, the prosperity gospel also appeals to the desperate and needy, countries where the people are impoverished and so desperate for some miracle or any form of help. These people hope the prosperity gospel is the answer to their problems. They become easy prey to these very wealthy pastors. To a person who is destitute, to look at a very rich pastor who offers riches, if you follow him, is enticing. So they give out of their poverty in hopes of a financial return. They end up worshiping mammon instead of the God of righteousness. So Jesus, preach the word. Stick with studying the word of God. Self-help can be helpful, but if it's not completely in line with the word of God, then it can end up being poison. Verse 3. Then they came to him, bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. And when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." Jesus dealt with the most important issue first, and that was the sins of the man. Jesus said in Matthew 18:8, "If your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life lame or maimed rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into the everlasting fire." Dealing with the sin issue in your life is priority. Verse 6, "And some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, 'Why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone?'" And they were correct in their assessment. Only God can forgive sins. But Jesus was simply acting according to his nature as God, and that was forgiving the sins of man. So Jesus wasn't blaspheming as the scribes thought. Verse 8, "But immediately, when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, 'Why do you reason about these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, "Your sins are forgiven you," or to say, "Arise, take up your bed and walk"?' If you say your sins are forgiven you, you don't really know if it happened. So technically, anyone can say it, and you can never verify if it happened. If you say, "Arise, take up your bed and walk," everyone will know if you're a fraud or not, because the man will either get up or not. If he doesn't get up, then you're a fraud and your words are meaningless and powerless. No one should believe you. So "arise, take up your bed and walk" is much more difficult to say. Verse 10, "But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, arise, take up your bed and go to your house." Immediately he arose, took up the bed and went out in the presence of them all, so that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw anything like this." So Jesus was saying, "Hey, I prove I have the power to forgive sins. I will say the more difficult thing. You can see if I'm a fraud or not, if my words have power or not. Arise, take up your bed and walk." Whoa, Jesus' words have power and authority. This paralytic just got up. This guy Jesus, he's got something. I believe his words. You can battle over words to no avail. Two sides debating, going back and forth, back and forth. But Jesus settled it right there. "You want me to prove my authority and my doctrine, that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins?" He said to the paralytic, "I say to you, arise, take up your bed and go to your house." Well, that kind of settles it. Jesus healed on command. That, my friend, is authority and power from on high. Verse 13. Then he went out again by the sea, and all the multitude came to him, and he taught them as he passed by. He saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax office, and he said to him, "Follow me." So he arose and followed him. Now it happened, as he was dining in Levi's house, that many tax collectors and sinners also sat together with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many, and they followed him. Now the tax collector Jesus called here was Matthew. Interesting, when you read Matthew's gospel, he doesn't tell you the dinner here, or great feast, as Luke says, was hosted by him. He hides that. And this shows Matthew's character. He doesn't need to brag about himself. Verse 16, and when the scribes and Pharisees saw him eating with the tax collectors and sinners, they said to his disciples, "How is it that he eats and drinks with tax collectors and sinners?" When Jesus heard it, he said to them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." The righteous Jesus is referring to is obviously the self-righteous, because there aren't any righteous people on earth who don't need to repent. The self-righteous feel like they don't need to repent of anything. Jesus didn't come here for them. It's true, everyone needs Jesus, but there are people whom God resists. And those are the proud, arrogant, and self-righteous. God resists these people. And in a sense, Jesus didn't come to call these people to repentance because of their arrogance. But in reality, they are in deep need of Jesus and repentance. But the Bible says many times, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Verse 18, the disciples of John and the Pharisees were fasting. Then they came and said to him, "Why do the disciples of John and of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast?" And Jesus said to them, "Can the friends of the bridegroom fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. But the days will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them, and then they will fast in those days." Fasting is a way to deny yourself and your flesh to focus on the Spirit and wait on the Lord. We often focus on the flesh and the needs of the flesh, but the flesh wars against the Spirit. If you always indulge in the desires of the flesh, then you might be quenching the Spirit. You can feed the Spirit through prayer, getting in the Word of God, worship, fellowship, and fasting. If you neglect these things, your spirit will get weak. If you don't have a Bible, because some places don't, you can meditate on what you do know. You can pray and worship. A lot of Chinese pastors who were thrown in jail in years past hid the Word of God in their hearts. They can't steal that from you. They sang in their cells and worshiped God. If they beat you, then you sang quietly to yourself. No need to ask for a beating if you can avoid one. We don't need to invite trouble. Jesus never said, "Get yourself in trouble and make the authorities hate you. This is honorable." Some Christians strangely like to get in people's faces and be highly obnoxious, and then say, "Oh, I'm being persecuted for righteousness' sake." No, you're being persecuted and hated because you're incredibly obnoxious. Stop shouting in the man's face, he's going to hell. Just let him eat his hot dog in peace. There are a lot of strange Christians out there. The more people hate them, the more righteous they feel. If other Christians don't like them, then they've attained the holy club that only the most holy can join. Verse 21. No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, or else the new piece pulls away from the old, and the tear is made worse. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins, or else the new wine bursts the wineskins. The wine is spilled, and the wineskins are ruined. But new wine must be put into new wineskins. New wine and old wineskins never work. That is, when God is doing a new work, it never fits into the old religious system. Some churches are stuck in their system of doing things. They apparently know how God works. He works through our programs, church activities, and organized outreaches. When God was moving among the hippies during the Jesus movement, many churches close their doors because those hippies are dirty. They felt if they wanted to get saved, they needed to clean up first. The new wine didn't fit the old wineskins. A lot of churches that are stuck in their old ways trade passion for programs, devotion for duty. It's my Christian duty. A love for Christ for churchianity. My church is so fun. So many things to do at church. The music is great. You know, God is not impressed nor moved by the fancy lights and fog machines. People say, "I was so moved by the music." But a lot of these people also get pumped at a secular concert. It was the environment that pumped them up. People mistaken physical excitement with a spiritual connection. They say, "I'm having a spiritual experience." But in reality, it's a physical experience. As your physical senses are stimulated, your eyes see the light show, the rising smoke, your ears hear the great musicians, and then you say, "I'm so into this worship. I feel so connected to God." But all the time, God was looking at the heart, and He sees your so-called connection was physical excitement. You see, true deep connection with God is long-lasting. It's not short-lived at a worship service. What you are really enjoying is the good music and the atmosphere. Rock concerts and clubs do the exact same thing. In fact, the church only copied what the world was already doing. People should want to go to church to escape the world, not copy the world and be like them. Good music, fancy lights, smoke machines, and the crowds love it. Great entertainment. Why do people go to clubs and rock concerts? Because of the entertainment and excitement. Who doesn't enjoy a good show, whether it's a musical, a play, a concert, a movie, or whatever you enjoy? But no, there is no spiritual value in these things unless there's a biblical theme with a deeper meaning which you can ponder about. When Paul and Silas were jailed, they prayed and sang hymns. No fancy music, just voices in simplicity and from the heart. When I first went to China back in 2007, we gathered in a small, cramped room. The room was tiny, but we just packed in. We sang with our voices only. And I'll be honest for a moment, I missed worship at a large church. And I missed the good music and great musicians and the atmosphere. I wished those there in the cramped room could experience the wonderful worship in America's large churches. I love the music, but as the weeks went by, I found something deeper. I began to realize all the good music in America is all superficial. The good music and great atmosphere doesn't bring you closer to God at all. What brings you close to God is when you strip away the noises, the sounds, the distractions of this world. Take away the fancy lights, the smoke, the distractions, and sit there with your heart focused on God in all simplicity, like Paul and Silas sitting in jail praying and worshiping God. And the prisoners were listening to them Acts 16:26. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open, and everyone's chains were loosed. I love great worship music, but when it comes to intimacy with God, the more you strip away the distractions of this world, the closer you'll get to Him. It's why Jesus and many of the prophets went into the wilderness, the deserts, the mountains, to be alone with God and away from the distractions of this world. Is there a time for worship concerts and such? Sure there is. I wouldn't go so far as to say what these churches are doing is sin. There are many types of ministries. If the Lord indeed did call them to that, then I'm not one to say the Lord is not in it. But there needs to be a balance. If you keep the people at church busy and distracted all the time, you're robbing them of a deeper connection to the Lord. I did not truly understand the simplicity until I went to China and we gathered in homes, house churches, and we fellowshipped and worshiped, prayed and studied the word with simplicity of heart. Acts 2:46. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. Now back in college, I understood a bit about this simplicity and intimacy with God. I had all my wisdom teeth pulled out, and I wanted to worship God, but all I could do was make noises. So I worshiped God just making noises. But being in China did open my eyes to something new, something deeper and more intimate. Well, back to the text. I believe a new wine is coming before the Lord's arrival. But many churches stuck in their old ways will not receive this new wine. It will burst the old wineskins. The religious system they have established won't hold the new wine. Verse 23. Now it happened that he went through the grain fields on the Sabbath, and as they went, his disciples began to pluck the heads of grain. And the Pharisees said to him, "Look, why do they do what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" But he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he was in need and hungry, he and those with him? How he went into the house of God in the days of Abiathar, the high priest, and ate the showbread, which is not lawful to eat except for the priests, and also gave some to those who were with him." Human need takes precedence over the law. It was not lawful for David to just eat the showbread, but because he was in need, it was okay for him to do so. A Pharisee's interpretation of the law says, it's better for a man to starve to death than to break God's law, even if they are ceremonial laws or kosher laws. Rahab was commended for her faith, even though she had to lie to save life. And during the time of Nazi Germany, no one criticized those who hid Jews to save their life when the SS police came knocking on their door. Human need and saving life always supersedes the law. Verse 27, and he said to them, "The Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is also Lord of the Sabbath." You see, the Pharisees serve the law. They serve the Sabbath as slaves to the Sabbath. So if you're dying and you need to get to a hospital, but it's on the other side of town, the Pharisees will just say, "Die or try to wait until tomorrow," because getting there would be considered work and you can't work. So they serve the Sabbath. Jesus said the Sabbath was made for man. You take the day off to do whatever you want. Just relax. If it's a 40-minute drive to the beach to relax, then knock yourself out. Sabbath was made for man to have a day off and relax and recover. If you work 7 days a week, It will do your body much good if you took a day off to just relax and do nothing. Let your mind rest. Let your body rest so you can begin the next work week refreshed. This is George Chuang teaching from Taiwan. If you would like to help me continue making videos, I would greatly appreciate your help on Patreon and PayPal. Your active participation will keep this ministry going, and may God grow His work here. Don't forget to use the Amazon link below to shop on Amazon. Just click the link and do your regular shopping. May God repay you for your help. And until next time, let us continue to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Oh, I love you, Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Bye-bye.